higher learning Brindavan campus, and also from the same year, he started translating Bhagwan's discourses in English. Currently, he's senior faculty, Department of Biosciences at Sri Sathya Institute of Higher Learning, Prashanthi Nilayam. He's an excellent orator and has been engaged in serving Swami in many capacities. His dynamism and enthusiasm is contagious, and he's a great source of inspiration to all his listeners, both in India and abroad. Welcome you, sir. Next, we have another renowned and distinguished gentleman, Sri Vijay Menon, who has a rich experience in training people across academia, governance, and corporations in leadership and management skills. He holds an MBA from the renowned Leeds Business School, UK. His professional career spans across various sections of society, and from his long list of endeavors, I will only name a few. He's a training panelist to train IAS officers of Government of India, has trained 645 IAS, IPS, IFS officers of India, and Royal Bhutan Civil Services of King of Bhutan. He has been the faculty panelist in the Kerala State Judges Training Academy under the High Court of Kerala Training Judges and Magistrates. He's the chief mentor of the flagship Leadership Intervention Ashwamedha, one of India's premier leadership interventions at the Indian Institute of Management, IIM, Indore, for the past 7 years. He's also the head organization development and advisor to the CEO Global Operations of SunTech Business Solutions Technopark Trivandrum, one of the world's leading companies in financial product software. He has trained women leaders of 39 leading companies in India and CEO of 65 blue chip companies under the Confederation of Indian Industry South India Chapter. Some of the names in his HRD clientele include Ramada Hotels, the Indian Navy, Bharat Petroleum Corporation, HSBC, ICICI Bank, to name a few. He's an ardent devotee of Bhagwan and is very active in spreading his teachings and is involved in a lot of Seva activities worldwide, some of which include 160 schools all over Asia have been initiated into the EHV program by him. In 2004, Bhagwan directed him to take up a unique Seva called Animal Seva to look after abandoned cows from slaughterhouses. About 270 cows are fed every day in various parts of Kerala. 110 Adivasi villages have been taken up in Wayanad for an upliftment under his leadership. And 4,500 children have been taught Vishnu Sahasranamam and are chanting it every day. We welcome you, sir. Now, I would like to introduce a member who is a beacon light to the youth, especially in Karnataka and also in Sai centers across India, Sri Vinay Kumar. He completed his degree from St. Joseph College and LLB from Bangalore University. He's fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, which he completed securing highest marks on all India basis in taxation. He secured fourth rank on all India basis in intermediate levels of Institute of Chartered Financial Analysts of India and the Institute of Cost and Work Accountants. He has 22 years of professional experience. He began his career as senior executive at Citibank and has worked his way up to the level of director. He readily resigned from his corporate career to dedicate himself in Sai Seva. He's currently a practicing chartered accountant and consultant to overseas funds engaged in infrastructure development within Asia. We all know Vinay Kumar sir as the Karnataka State Youth Coordinator and member board of management of Sathya Sai Trust Karnataka. At a most critical and trying period of his life, Sri Vinay Kumar was engulfed into Swami's fold with the most potent assurance that one can ever be blessed with: I am there for you. Ever since, there has been no looking back for him. He was fortunate to interact closely with Bhagwan and receive direct guidance for conducting landmark events such as Atirudra Mahayagya, Shiva Parvati Kalyana, amongst many, many others. And he also received specific directions in refining programs such as the VIP Grama Seva Initiative. We welcome you, sir. I now request Sri Sanjay Sahani, sir, to take over the proceedings of the panel discussion. Sai.
Offering my loving pranam at the lotus feet of my beloved Lord, welcoming my esteemed panelists for today's panel discussion, Professor Anil Kumar, Sri Vinay Kumar and Sri Vijay Menon. Revered elders, brothers and sisters. One of our elders, one of our elders mentioned the other day, to love Bhagwan is to love his words. And if you have to love his words, it's also important that we understand the true import of his words. Today's panel discussion is on a theme which is directly taken from Bhagwan's own dicta. And our endeavor would be to explore the nuances of this theme and in society and in the forest. We also would like, as the panel discussion proceeds, for your response. If you have queries relating to what our esteemed panelists have to say on the discussion, you can send over your questions written in a slip of paper, and as the moderator of today's program, I will pose the questions to the appropriate panelists and seek his response. For this purpose, we have a set of volunteers on the bench side. Can the volunteers raise their hand? Yes. So, you have seen them. You can spread yourselves and you could just pass on your slips of paper where you have your query and they will pass it on to me and then I will pose that question to the panel. On the women's side, can the volunteers raise their hand? Two, okay. So please stand up so that all can see. Yeah, so we have, these are our volunteers. So you could pass on the slip of paper, maybe you can keep moving and we will receive the questions for further discussion. Thank you. So please, I request the volunteers, keep the alert, receive the questions and keep passing it on to the dais. Hands in society, head in the forest. I'm reminded of two anecdotes. An American devotee of Bhagwan by name Isaac asked Bhagwan this question. Bhagwan, you have given me the capacity to go deep into meditation. And I am tempted to go to some cave and meditate there all the time. Is this appropriate for me? And this was Bhagwan's response. He said that any other time in history, this would have been fine. But at the current juncture, there is a great need for us to be in society. Be in the world, but do not be victimized by it. There is a need for beacons of light in society, and the time is now to be in society and work for your own spiritual evolution through your work in society. The second anecdote, Swami was speaking to students and he said, it is not necessary for you to wear a kashayan vastra, an orange dress. You can be dressed the way you are, in your natural attire. But even as you live an ordinary life, lead a spiritual life and become an example to others. Swami Vivekananda said, renunciation and service are our national ideals. Bhagwan Baba says, Dil mein raag, haath mein kaam is the motto that you should carry with you when you walk and pass through life the world. I thought these are some questions that the panelists would like to think about and deliberate upon. What is the meaning of the statement, hand in society and hand in the forest? Why is it essential that our head should be in the forest? And if there is a necessity to reconcile both, then what should be the proportion of the balance? Should 80% be hands in society and 20% head in the forest? Or is it the reverse? Or is it 50-50? What kind of balance are we really looking at? And if we are aiming for that balance, how do we achieve that balance? How do we strive for that balance? And what are the challenges we face in our day-to-day life in effecting that balance? So with these few opening remarks, I now request each one of my panelists to say in a few introductory remarks what they feel about this topic and what they think is the scope of this subject. First, over to you, man. So we have Anil Kumar, sir, starting to proceed.
I love everybody. I'm so happy to be here this morning in your midst, having been here in this campus for 6 long years as a principal. I'm extremely happy to see the auditorium with as much of grandeur and glory as before. Congratulations to the principal, Professor Sathya. I'm asked to speak to you introductory words and I'm unfit for introduction. You should have liked to explain this. But anyway, let me tell you, in the beginning itself, the moderator made it clear that we should love his words. But I add, love his words in action. If you simply love his words, it is only political platform lecturing. Heroes on platform, heroes in practice. Therefore, an ounce of practice is better than ton of speeches. Love his words man, translating his words in our life. And second, while that super specialty hospital, there in the Shantanya was under construction. All our boys are involved in doing Seva, Sramadhan, lifting bags of cement and also the sand to the work spots. And I was asked to supervise. I was there, boys are doing work. Suddenly Swami came there, got down and called me. What are you doing? I said, Swami, boys are at work. I just directed them. Baba said, poor direction. Poor direction. Then I said, Swami, what? Baba said, I want you to do work singing God's name. Singing God's name. So when work has to be done, it has to be clubbed with the glory of God in the sun. Because that gives us enough of energy and the boost while doing our work that God Swami said. And second point he referred to, you can be in society that we don't have to run away from society. My friends, society is not separate. Society is God. Samaja. Sama equals ja, born out of that. So samaja, society, is the collective cosmic form of the divine. While I am the individual, yeshti, society is samishti, with the divinity, parameshti, flowing through. Therefore, when you are in society, we have to know that we are in God, with God, and society is not separate. And where in special dress, we have made sufficient mockery of the dress. As Baba says, Kasai Vekam, Kasai Vekam, Kasai Vekam, author wrote, Kasai Vekam, poison inside. So it is not the dress. Buddha Baba says, Buddha Kalaya, Gunal Pensukoni, is not the dress. Gunal qualities that matter. The challenge is, he said, there are two extremes now. One that finds the materialism of the world is the ultimate. They are materialists. What we say, society, if I am to do like that. The other extreme, heavenly forest, spiritualist, self-designated, of course. So spiritualists on one extreme, materialists on the other extreme. But both are equally wrong. Materialists enjoy themselves by indulgence, while spiritualists happy by avoidance. Indulgence, avoidance are equally bad, because spirituality is transcendent. Transcendence is spirituality. Whether you are in it or out of it, the spirit of it runs in it. The balanced state of mind is very important. And the challenge is hard to break both of them. In fact, they are not separate. Hands in society does not mean that I am going to keep both my hands here, head in the fire, in the nearby fire. It's not so. We elaborate just more and more as we discuss the scene. Because I don't want to take lion's share of the time, because two young chaps, they should be exposed. It is time for the younger generation to be exposed, given number of chances. We have had our heydays, had our innings earlier. It's time to visit here. If there is some masala here, I'm always available at your service. Sai Ram!
Thank you, Professor. And now I request Vinay Kumar to give his introductory remarks on the theme.
Sairam to all of you. How many of us present here don't want to be happy? How many of us present here want to be happy? The happiness is actually the index of spiritual growth. And Swami used to always say, be happy, be happy, be happy. In fact, this saying, hands in society, heads in the forest, is a clear prescription by Swami for all of us to scale the heights of happiness in life. There is a shloka which at the end of the bhajan, Swami would insist that we repeat it twice. In fact, physically he would make everybody repeat it twice on so many occasions. Samastha Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. Most of you must have heard it. How many of you have not heard it? All of you have heard it? Have all of you heard it? This? Can we say it once? Samastha Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. The only way this can happen, in a very simple way, is if we balance our life in society and ensure spiritual growth also happens on the other side. Heads in the forest doesn't mean we go and sit in the forest, because in today's time, a few years back, if you went to the nearby forest, you would probably have bars into Veerappan or somebody like that. And the basic concept behind this saying of Swami, which is so simple in its content but so huge in substance, is we need to bring out a balance between our work life and the spiritual life. It is so relevant for all of us as a student, as a working professional, as a member of society, to ensure that we have balanced ourselves correctly in life. And this is the only way Swami prescribes happiness will be there with us forever. This is actually the way I am looking at this saying, hands in society, heads in the forest, is a prescription to our happiness.
Thank you, Vinay. Remembering Swami, on the word forest, he said, forest is for rest. Forest is for rest. So if you want rest for the mind, you must have head in the forest. And in society, anywhere we have, but head in the forest is for rest and peace for the mind. Over to the Vijayana.
Sai Ram. My dear friends, if you look at what Bhagwan Baba said to all of us to observe in life, you would find that one of the greatest things that Bhagwan told all of us was about a judicious balance in terms of spiritual pursuit and social betterment. You know, to be frankly speaking, if you look at it from a holistic perspective, you would understand a lot of it is about the kind of mind that we have at this point of time, the state of mind that we have at this point of time. I'll give you a very simple illustration from the annals of Indian culture and tradition. One of the Maharshis of India was walking through a very small hamlet or village. He sees a cow in a spot of bother because that cow was injured and it was bleeding to death. Now, a lot of small children were playing close to that particular spot. None of them were looking at this particular cow with tremendous amount of pity and commiseration. This particular Rishi, who was adept in all the Shastras of Vedanta, he goes and starts nursing that particular cow. In the process of nursing that particular cow, he identifies himself so much with that particular suffering that he becomes extremely emotional. He ensures that that particular cow was given the most compassionate treatment. He gets up and starts walking. All the youngsters go and tell him, "You've set a great example for all of us to follow." He said, "What is it?" They said, "The very act of lavishing love on a cow, and that to a person like you who is a renunciate, who's supposed to be exceptionally good when it comes to only spiritual matters, you're personifying practical action." You know what this person said? This is exactly what Bhagwan Baba was advising us in his glorious avatarhood to make us understand that ultimately when you talk about spirituality and service, it's essentially synonymous. It's essentially the same thing. Bhagwan said, the Rishi said, "The only reason why I was nursing the cow was because I was innately selfish." He said, "I was intrinsically selfish." The children were completely stunned and astounded. They said, "Selfish?" He said, "When I saw the pain of that particular cow, the pain of that particular cow became mine. I was nursing that cow to remove my pain." My dear friends, this is exactly what is the blend of spirituality and service. Now the question in front of all of you is, you know, we all talk, armchair critics that we all are, we sit and talk about what are the problems of the country, we talk about the problems in terms of poverty, malnutrition, but how many of us have taken the trouble to understand, touch the soul of India? If you touch the Atma of India, that is when you become spiritual. The concept of Samaj Seva that Sir was talking about becomes automatic only when you ground yourself in the traditions of Bharat. I'll give you one more example and then give the mic back to Sir. You know, 99% of people in the world talk about Swami Vivekananda as a youth icon. All of us sitting here are youth members. It becomes imperative for us to understand the anatomy of the man. And 99% of people say Swami Vivekananda was a person who delivered one of the most blistering speeches in Chicago, right? In 2 seconds, he could galvanize a group of people to stand up and give a standing applause for a simple salutation, sisters and brothers of America. Mind you, this came before the speech and not after the speech. My dear friends, as youngsters, do a scientific analysis. Swami Vivekananda himself has said, the reason why in 2 seconds he was able to produce that kind of electrifying impact was not because of communication skills, was not because of Victorian English, was because for 3 years from 1890 to 1893 August, he traversed the length and breadth of India, went to thousands and thousands of villages, saw poverty, saw impoverishment, saw exploitation, saw suffering, and he came back and said, "My Atma is on fire." It is only when a person is able to expose himself in this particular fashion that you're able to blend your nama with karma. It's very, very important to blend nama with karma. Kathopanishad, the introduction given by the greatest Adishankara, one simple line. If all the youngsters were to just remember this line till the end of life, all of us would lead lives, as Vinay rightly asked, all of us would lead lives that are happy, not for a second, but for a lifetime. What did Adishankara say? Praninam sakshat abhyutaya nishreyasa hetu. I repeat, praninam sakshat abhyutaya. What is abhyutaya? Your material welfare, become the best chartered accountant, becomes the best doctor, becomes the best administrator, no problem. But Adishankara cautioned, abhyudaya nishreyasa. What is it? You've got to do samaj seva. You've got to erase the remnants of ego by plunging into universal karma, universal work, suffering of humanity. Abhyudaya nishreyasa hetu. What is hetu? Connecting link, embodying philosophy. So my dear friends, I think at some, we'll start with this, but I think at some point of time we have to understand both of this are complementary, both of this exist together. Saida.
Two important points that you mentioned. One is that when you do seva, you become humble. And that's a very important gain for the spiritual aspirant. The other is that this was a dictum which Swami gave us at the first All India Seva Conference. He said, with what bhava or attitude should you take up service? He said, you're not serving somebody else, you're serving your own self. When you relieve the pain of another, actually you empathize with that individual in your own heart and you are effectively removing your own pain. So thank you, Vijay. And now I go to the first round of questions. My first question is to Professor Anil Kumar. So you record that we must do work with Swami's name, the Lord's name. But many times when we are associated with our work, it could be personal, it could be social, it could be professional. Our whole mind is occupied with the work. And if we really honestly ask ourselves, we are not remembering the Lord. What does this statement mean? That we should take His name and simultaneously keep doing our work. Does it mean that every one act that you do, remember it, and then the second act, I mean, is it practical? So what does it mean from a practical point of view?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. A good question raised indeed. But I seek your special purpose to draw your attention to one important point. When I come ask the question, how many would you like to be happy? How do you want to be unhappy? Happy as the good Baba, happiness lies in union with God. Happiness lies in union with God. And where is God? He is in everyone. He is in Vasudeva Sarvam. Ishavasyagadam Sarvam. Yatpinta Jagatjangad. Jena Chitayana Bhutriga. Vasudakta Chitayana. He is a master of Uttara. A very awareness that God is present in everyone is enough that gives you ultimate happiness. And then the second point now is work with hands on one hand and spiritual growth on the other hand. They are not parallel, they are not separate. I cannot say that spiritual growth in me, being an incompetent professor at the university, professional excellence, academic excellence, physical excellence, intellectual excellence, human excellence is divine. That is spirituality. So therefore, this point has not been borne the mind without bifurcating the two aspects, the excellence of work and the spiritual growth. And reservation. Yes, youngest of them, group here. Well, that is about love. Yes, Swami gave a number of examples. But I don't want to take much of your time by adding some more anecdote, which I very well remember. But suffice if I say this, love in action is service. Therefore, mere service without love is mechanical, computerized, programmed, lifeless, passive, tasteless, insipid, hopeless. Whereas the same word, the God's name, becomes dynamic, vital, full of life, meaningful, purposeful. And this love in active service. And love is not separate from God. Love is God. God is love. Live in love. That's what Bhagavan says. And then I could also tell you, Mr. Moderator, what Bhagavan said a number of times, there is a Brindavan said. You don't have to bother, a great answer to your question, sir. Well, you don't have to bother that I have got my work on one hand, how to repeat his name on the other. I can't go to my class and go and see him there unless I want my students to be lovers of concept of music appearing for supplemental examinations. It's not so. What Baba said is this. Sarva karma bhagavata vidyartha. All my actions be pleasing unto God. That is enough. It's not necessary that I should repeat his name. A mere offering to God. At the beginning, O Swami, see that all my actions are pleasing unto you. And towards the close of the day, we would rather even say, all the great, everything Swami, you made an instrument, that the credit or discredit, karma phala, is surrendered to you. Therefore, karma phala parityaga, that is held in the body. So karma is handsome. Karma phala parityaga, the sacrifice of the result of the consequence of the action is the mind. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. What was our Kumar sir underlying for us was that when you do work dedicated to God with the feeling that this is not for the family or for the organization you belong to, but it is your offering to God. That work itself becomes worship and becomes outstanding. If you see Indian culture, some of the best works and the most lasting works of our culture are those which have been dedicated to God. So many things were there, they built palaces, the palaces no longer exist. But the Indian genius was invested in temple architecture, and there are temples in our country which have lasted centuries. There are so many authors who have written books, but Valmiki wrote Ramayana, dedicated to God, and even today, we read Ramayana, we deliberate about the truths of Ramayana. So, thank you, sir, for that wonderful insight. That do work, but do it as dedication to the Lord, and that is equivalent to remembering Him. Now my question is to Mr. Vinay Kumar. Mr. Vinay Kumar is a professional chartered accountant, and I'm sure that balancing spiritual life and the professional life must be a daily experience for him. Mr. Vinay, could you give some advice for our youth here? How this balancing could be done, especially youth when they join the organization? They join their professional life. They find it that they have hardly any time for service activities, etc. So any personal tips, suggestions, can you elaborate based on your own experience of how we could do service to society along with our professional career?
At this point, I would like to narrate to you a simple teaching which Swami himself way. In fact, this is a dilemma which most of us face at a certain age. Should I pursue professional excellence or should I go and be part of an organization which is tutoring me on spiritual growth and devote a lot of time on dhyana, meditation, yoga? Most of you here through the summer course have gone through pranayama, meditation, yoga, bhajan, vedam, going through these day-long sessions which is steeped into Indian culture and spirituality. None of this is directly related to your professional growth in some sense. So this dilemma is always there in our minds. I think the simple solution which Swami gave was, he said, time will expand when you do good work. Time will expand when there are good thoughts. And he said the correct utilization of time and the demarcation of time for different activities is the key to building up the right balance in life. For example, in my own case as a professional, there are so many challenges which many of us here face. As a student, as a working professional, we have a 9, 10, 12 hour long day which needs to be gone through for our sustenance and livelihood. Some part of us also wants peace from within. Some part of us is craving to be on our own. How do we balance the two? Once time gets allocated clearly, that was his fundamental answer to this. He said, there is time for all activities. You can never say that you are short of time to allocate your work between spirituality and your worldly pursuit. Once time gets allocated clearly, time will automatically expand and you will have sufficient time to take care of all these. I just want to at this point also add something to what Professor Anil Kumar sir had mentioned. The one important thing to also look at when we are doing an activity, like Swami said, surrender of course is the key, and in fact that is the Mula Mantra. Once you surrender every act and action to God, automatically God will take care of the effect of that action. But what kind of act needs to be surrendered to God? I cannot go and murder somebody and say I am surrendering this act to God. I can't go and steal something and say I am surrendering this to God. I can't make a blatant lie to somebody and say I am surrendering it to God. Or indulge in a professional practice which is most unethical and say I have surrendered it to God, therefore this activity is anyway sanctified. Swami said, before you do any activity, ask a question to yourself, am I man or am I animal? Am I a man, am I an animal? Once we ask this question to ourselves, automatically the inner voice will tell us whether the particular act is right, justified, judicious or not. And I think that inner voice is the guide. And this inner voice, like sir was saying, is part of us. Because this happiness is latent and inert in us in the form of God. So that, I think, these are the two prescriptions. One is to listen to the inner voice to bring the balance in life. Second is to ensure that we don't trip about lack of time. Because time is there in abundance. In fact, I think there is a clear prescription given by Swami on how to utilize the 24 hours in a day. And this judicious allocation of time, though there is no hard fast prescription, will lead us to ensure that there is the right balance between the two. Sir.
Once more, I got to Rajasthan. This was a question with the lady of the house, was a young housewife, put to me. She had two small kids, maybe about 3 years old. And obviously she had been a Bal Vikas guru earlier. So she expressed this dilemma that because of my child, I'm not able to do Bal Vikas work now. And she's feeling very guilty about it. And this is what I explained to her. Do not think that only taking a Bal Vikas class is doing Swami's work. Even taking care of your two kids at home who need you at this juncture is Bal Vikas. And at this particular juncture, if you take care of your kids, when they grow up and grow up well, you have all the time to take care of other children. First, charity begins at home. So similarly for a professional, for 6 days in a week, you work for the organization. At least the seventh day, don't work for yourself. Work for society. If a doctor is there for 6 days, he is treating people for money. On the seventh day, he can join some medical camp and do some service. In fact, in our own university, here in Brindavan, what happens on a Sunday morning? Is it a holiday? Yes, it is a holiday. But on Sunday morning, 6:15, if you are in the campus, you will find the teachers and the students spread all over the campus doing various service activities. There is a very subtle point which we are inculcating in our students. Don't think Sunday is meant to be a holiday. Sunday is a community day. 6 days you have done so many activities for yourself, the studies and games, etc. Sunday morning is for service, and that is why on every Sunday morning at 6:15, they are not sleeping in their bed. They have no other responsibility for the day, but they are there in the campus to do seva. So allocation of time for different things is something which is very, very important.
Also add here that these days, most corporates, working environments understand that a certain amount of time has to be devoted and dedicated to serve society. This has become a part and parcel of corporate culture. In fact, corporate social responsibility is such a huge topic and point of concern now, where people within the company, within working organizations, devote a lot of time even as part of their working time. In fact, I know of a large organization in Bangalore which makes it compulsory for senior executives to dedicate at least 1 hour every week in community service. And this they do with a lot of diligence. So it need not necessarily be that we are running off hundreds of kilometers away in search of a forest, in search of a tribal area, or in search of a village and doing seva. Any good act which is done with devotion and surrender to God, with an intent to serve community, I think automatically justifies into that bracket of heads in the forest.
Thank you, Anil. Now my question to Dave. Dave, you said that serving the society helps you to remove your ego. Now that's a very important spiritual gain, because no matter what you do, the ego doesn't disappear. Even the spiritual ego is very powerful. So could you explain this, how the process of serving the society leads to the removal or the annihilation of the ego?
Sai Ram, the reason why I said that particular statement is because, I'll just give you a simple example. 19 years ago, I had the opportunity as a devotee of Bhagwan Baba to go to the general hospital cancer ward in my hometown, Cochin. Now every single bed, you look at it very dispassionately, every single bed, what do you see there? You see pain, you see agony, you see suffering, but what is more important is you see a sense of helplessness. Now you get into the particular ward with tremendous amount of ego, conceit and pride, but after 10 minutes when you see what you see, that is when you understand how insignificant, how small and how limited our finite structure is. And you come out of that particular cancer ward thinking that the only thing that matters in life is to be relevant to humanity. So the point is, you know, what is ego? Bhagwan himself has said that ego is a kind of an overemphasis to the self. Now, how do you get this particular overemphasis balanced or tempered? It is only by exposing your mind to those scenarios or contexts wherein you understand every small thing that I have at this point of time is so priceless. You know, I'll give you a simple example. 3 weeks ago when I went to the cancer ward of the general hospital, I saw a lady 46 years of age. When she was inhaling, it was okay, but when she was exhaling, there was a deafening noise. And the nurse was saying that there is not even one single part of the brain which is not afflicted with cancer. That whole place was completely, almost like, you know, cordoned off. And this lady, the nurse is showing, in the close to the feet, there is a particular nerve through which injections are being given. And she said there is no nerve in the hand to give an injection because for 8 years, everything has been exhausted. Now the point is, you walk into this particular cancer ward thinking that you're somebody. You walk into this particular cancer ward with tremendous amount of emphasis on the I, but when you get in, what happens? You understand, my God, it takes 1 second in life for everything to go. The moment you understand and meditate on this very sacred truth, in 1 second, everything that we have can go, you become truly spiritual. That's why Bhagwan Baba said, living in the present is spirituality. When do you live in the present? It is only when you understand that this is the only moment which has been given to you. And to get it, you've got to seek those moments that would make you understand. I'll give you one simple illustration and conclude this. One of the yogis of India was asked a very simple question. The question was, what is the difference between happiness and sorrow? What is the difference between success and failure? Now, the greatness of the Mahatmas of India, in one simple statement, they would encapsulate the essence of Vedanta. You know what he said? He never gave an explanatory answer. He said, the difference between happiness and sorrow, 1 second. The difference between success and failure, 1 step. And he said, the day you recognize these two things, your life will become truly spiritual. So, to answer this particular question or round off, annihilation of ego starts only when you understand your broader, wider, deeper, diviner identity. To get there, it is important to understand how fickle, how unpredictable, how helpless all of us are in a broader sense of the word, to understand the realities of life. So I would put it this way, when you take your mind close to reality, you understand the basic architecture of life, and that becomes a humbling experience. Sai Ram.
This ego, about this ego, there was one, once I had an opportunity to ask Swami, two questions, which is, I think, very relevant to all of us here, and somewhere it fits into the subject matter. Said, Swami, at this age, there are two things which keep troubling us. One is lack of control over senses, and the second is ego. How do we control this, and what is your solution? Swami, in his infinite wisdom, quipped immediately. He said, as far as control over senses, live with Sai and your senses will fly. Live with Sai is essentially this topic which we are discussing today. The head in the forest does not mean a forest, but the head at the lap of our mother Sai, which is the succor for all worldly ills. As far as ego is concerned, he said, most of you understand Kannada, right? I will tell it in Kannada because he gave the answer in Kannada, and then we'll translate it into English. ಸರ್, ನಾನು ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಸೃಷ್ಟಿ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ನಿಮಗೆ ಈಗೋ ಕೊಡಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ದಾರಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲೋ ನೀವು ತಗೊಂಡು ಬಂದಿದ್ದೀರಾ. ಹೋಗೋದು ಮುಂಚೆ ದಾರಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಬಿಟ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಹೋಗ್ಬಿಡು. ಇಸ್ ವೆನ್ ಐ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ಯು, ಐ ಡೆಂಟ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟ್ ಯು ವಿತ್ ಈಗೋ. ಯು ಪಿಕ್ಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಅಪ್ ಆನ್ ದ ವೇ. ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಯು ಕಮ್ ಟು ದಿ ಎಂಡ್, ಡ್ರಾಪ್ ಇಟ್ ಅಪ್ ಆನ್ ದ ವೇ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕ್ಯಾರಿ ಆನ್. ಸೊ ಈಗೋ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಮ್ ವಿತ್ ಅಸ್. ಈಗೋ ಇಸ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ವಿಚ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕಾನ್ಶಿಯಸ್ಲಿ gone and picked up. Ego comes only when we create an alter ego for ourselves. There is another part of us which is created by us, knowingly, unknowingly, covertly or overtly. It is created by us, and that is what generates this ego. So I think it is high time that before we come to the end of our journey, we give it up, because that is what Swami said. Give it up on the way, just as I didn't give it to you and you picked it up on the way. Sir.
Thank you, sir. Ego seems to be an important center of discussion now. Let us all resolve to say, O ego, let you go. Baba gives one example. Football. How many of you watch a football game? Raise your hands. Good. The football, full of air inside, is kicked by players on both sides, fana fana like that, to the goal. But when once the football is deflated, air taken out of it, who can kick it? Nobody. One has to lift it up. Similarly, an egoistic man is a football with air, kicked by everybody on the street. When one's ego is gone, lifted, that's the example Baba has given. The second, because of long association of 40 years with Swami, naturally I am tempted to speak along these lines. To cut short your ego, what is the easy technique? It's quite easy to say, oh, ego, okay. How to be free from ego? Baba gives you easy solution. In the lunar system, in the solar system, in the entire universe, there's so many countries, and so much of water. Earth is simple planet. And in this earth, there's so many countries. India is one country of the size of an ant. India is the size of an ant. When compared to the galaxy, the entire planetary system. And in India, Karnataka is the size of eye of an ant. And in this Karnataka eye of an ant, Whitefield is the speck in the eye of an ant. What is there to feel proud of? And nobody. So let us consider how small we are when compared to the entire gamut, the galaxy outside is one. Third one, Baba gives this example. How a man without ego works. Supposing I say, you are a great man, huh? Have you realized today? I'm great since long. Some may feel like that. So, how a man without ego functions? An example Baba has given. Towards the end of Ramayana, all are praised, you are great. And all praise Hanuman. You have taken a major role. You are responsible for the union of the divine couple. You are responsible for this Pattabhishekam coronation. You are great. Hanuman started crying. And all rishis said, why do you cry? We are appreciating you, giving you some Padma Bhushan. Why do you cry? Hanuman says, have I done that? No. Is it not the blessing and the divine will of Ramachandra made me to do? Is it not the blessings and the best wishes of all of you that made me cross that mighty ocean? You are responsible. Lord is responsible. What am I? That is the attitude, reaction of a man without ego. Third example, Baba himself. All people came to Swami from Anantapur district. Swami, you have taken up this water project. 700 villages are benefited by you. We have come here to thank you. Baba said, no. I should thank you. You don't have to thank me. You have given an opportunity to serve you. You and I are not suffering. We are one. That is egolessness.
Thank you, sir. Now we go to the next round. And lots of questions have come from our participants. So my first question to Professor Anil Kumar. In Indian culture, we have four ashramas, one of which is Vanaprastha Ashrama. So the question is, when Vanaprastha Ashrama is anyway compulsory for everybody, what is the need for practicing this head in the forest and body in society, when anyway in Vanaprastha Ashrama we will be doing it? So in Brahmacharya and Grahastha, we can be the way we are. What is your opinion on this?
How many fellows are following Vanaprastha today? There may be Vana rain, no Prastha. Nobody is following Vanaprastha, gas number one. Because he wants to earn money for grandchildren, great-grandchildren, future yet to be born children, call it Vanaprastha. That Vanaprastha may be age limit for retirement. That's all. But actual Vanaprastha, what is actual Vanaprastha? According to Dharma Vahini. Dharma Vahini is a text written by Baba. What has he said about Vanaprastha? Vanaprastha is a period after retirement, fellows like me. What are we supposed to do? Hand over whole thing to your children. delegate responsibilities to every one of them. Supervise, give them guidance when they need it. If you unnecessarily guide them, it's interference. If they ask you, it's proper direction. So, delegating, distributing things, be a witness, guide them, tell them what is to be done. That is one of the steps. Later comes sannyasashrama, where you forget what you are doing. Well, you don't know anything at all. If your son asks, Daddy, what shall I do? It is your job. My job is over. Thank you. Daddy, I want to build a house. Why not do? Don't bother about it. That is sannyasashrama. So vanaprastha is handing over charge. Just play the role of a director and guide. And no one is doing today. Hari Om.
Our next question is to Sri Vinay Kumar. Daily life in the world is so busy. In this busy schedule, how do we connect to Bhagwan and be close to Him?
Bhagwan is not far away from us, He is part of us. So there is no question of trying to get close to Him. But there was a simple answer again, because I don't think, at least I on this panel, am capable of giving answers to most of these queries raised. But fortunately, Swami has been answering some of these queries over a period of time. This query also, He gave a very beautiful answer. He said, when you get up in the morning, the moment you rise up, spend 1 minute for me. Just think of me, He said. When you have completed your morning work, again spend a minute for me. And then in between He said, will you be able to spend at least that 1 minute for me? And towards the end of the day, after you have finished everything, again spend a minute for me in silence. In fact, the greatest mantra which was given by Swami time and again, whenever you go to Him and ask Him, Swami, this problem, that problem, this is not happening, that is not happening, we thought it will happen like this, but it did not turn out that way, because this is a normal thing which all of us go through. Two words He would always say, Sumne Iru. This is the greatest teaching, I think. Sumne Iru, just be quiet. Being quiet did not mean be shut and become dumb. Being quiet meant in silence be with me. And that 3 minutes in a day just to be with Him in absolute silence is enough to get totally connected to Him. In fact, that creates the clean bonding. It is always there. Eternally this bond is always there. But it just energizes that bond and fastens it and makes it even more stronger. So this simple act of spending some time with the Lord, in spite of all our busy schedule, because that is what He has written, I think, in spite of busy schedule, I think this is the same question which was in Kannada. He said, Besaraguttade, that's the word He used. He said, I get upset and it affects me with all the trials and tribulations of life. Yeah, Manasu Vatradaliye Irutade, He Gidru now Baba Ravara Manasige, Hattira Vagavudu Hege. Busy life, Dudime, Anarogya, Ityadi, health related issues, material issues, so many other issues, work related issues. In spite of all this, how do we remain close to Him? I think the simple act is Swami is always there. It's a door which is always open. We just need to knock and He's there to answer. I don't think He is far away from us at all. The moment we spend that little time with Him, the answer comes immediately.
Personal example. Personal, because Swami said so many things, and I also inform you that what all Swami said are not totally applicable to everybody, because those teachings are set to different levels of people, to different levels of awareness. What He tells to Kamadhani is different from V.K. Gopa. What He tells me is different from others. So I cannot generalize it. But I can tell you a simple example. Even if you don't think of Him, he thinks of you. That is such a Sai Baba. I give you example. While I was here in Bangalore, I was to leave my daughter at the airport on her way to US. Well, I took her to the airport, baggage, everything is sent. She was having a boy, baby, a few months old. I didn't know that boy requires a ticket. Because in India we are used to ticketless traveling. So I never thought that ticket is required for a baby. They said nothing to get out. Correct, baggage is sent. She already boarded the aircraft. She asked to get down. She came crying, Nana, what shall I do? Well, immediately I rushed to the office and then asked the accountant, sir, what is to be done? Tickets must be purchased. All right, how much should I pay? This is some 900 rupees or so, they said, which I was not carrying in my pocket. We don't carry thousands like that. I'm not a black marketer. So what am I to do? Then I said, sir, I don't have any paisa with me. I'm the principal of Sathya College, Whitefield, Bangalore. Sir, you can send the check later, let the child go and give me the ticket. That is Sathya Sai Baba. Who will be there before any job or any challenges or situation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Just one advice for all our youth, because this is the specific request. How do we connect to Bhagwan? Can we spare 10 minutes in the Brahma Muhurtam, 4 a.m. to 6 a.m.? See, that is what you are practicing every day. Can you give 10 minutes of your time during the Brahma Muhurtam? Try it for 1 week and then we'll discuss what happens after that. My next question is to Vijay Menon. What advice would you give to the youth of today regarding this saying in their day-to-day life? As one of the major influences that they face is of the peer group who are operating in a different direction. Even when our family is spiritually and culturally strong, the peer group leads us in the opposite direction. So how do we practice this countering the pressure of the peer group? Vijay Manan.
Sai Ram. My job is that of designing a strategy for a battle. Okay, I'll give you a very simple example. One of the American devotees of Bhagwan, when Bhagwan finished giving him a wonderful interview, as he was coming out of the interview room, he turned and looked at Bhagwan and said, Bhagwan, I love you. Swami smiled and acknowledged. And as this person was leaving the outer room, he turns once again in a very feeble voice, he says, I love you. You know what Swami asked? Swami said, do you doubt it? Simple question, do you doubt it? See, the reason why a lot of things don't happen in the life of a youth constructively is because of this one example. It's because, you know, 99% of us have interests. Very few people take interest to the level of a belief, and fewer graduate a belief to the level of conviction. The answer is given in the Indian tradition as one simple word, Swadhyayam. What is Swadhyayam? It is conviction will develop only when you understand the scriptures of India. Bhagwan Baba has spoken about Ramayana, Ramkatha Rasvahini. Bhagwan Baba has spoken about Upanishads. You know, if you start reading all the works of Bhagwan Baba, the exceptional commentaries of Bhagwan Baba, that is when you not just understand spirituality, you understand that this is the only single thing that would exist in your life throughout. You understand the eternal meaning of the messages of the Indian scriptures only when you read what Bhagwan Baba has told us to understand. So the point is, today, average youth, we look at miracles of Bhagwan Baba, we talk about the leelas of Bhagwan Baba, but we don't understand the interpretations of the scriptures given by Bhagwan Baba that would help us be convinced of the importance and primacy of spiritual search. I will give you one simple example for it. You know, just to give you an example of what is true conviction. Look at all of us today. If I were to ask you a question, 99% of you would give an answer in less than 1 second about IPL cricket matches. If I were to ask you a question about celebrity pregnancies, 100% of you would speak about it. I'm being very honest here because I don't have anything to hide. If I were to ask you about the favorite color of a Bollywood actor, you would give a 1.5 hour lecture on it. But I'm asking the simple question, how many of us have understood the basic ABC of this great culture and civilization of India? If you have not, how would you get convinced of it? Have you gone to a Konark Sun Temple and looked at that wonderful creation 747 years ago from one block of stone, transported through the tumultuous waters of Mahanadi with a lock, the sages of India? Have you gone to Delhi and looked at that beautiful stupa that has weathered 637 monsoons without a speck of rust? I'm asking this question because if you don't see this, how do you become convinced? It would just become what is called a fleeting obsession. It comes and goes. It comes with a, you know, you start tailoring your beliefs to become popular in a particular peer group. So to be convinced is to expose your mind to the hoary traditions of India. That's why Bhagavan said, Swadhyayam. You know, I would be the happiest here. It's a personal request that I want to make to all of you. If you want a game changer in life, if you want that eternal conviction to come, before you go out of the summer course to your respective homes and towns and cities, it would be wonderful if you could go to the bookshop here and pick up Satyam Shivam Sundaram and Sathya Sai Speaks. I'm telling you, if this doesn't change your life, nothing else would. If this doesn't give you conviction, nothing else would. But the point is, are we willing to make that investment in terms of time to be convinced of the eternal, unimpeachable nature of everything that is denoted by the term Indian culture and spirituality? So please start reading it to be convinced. Number two, Louis Fisher, the biographer of Mahatma Gandhi, has said, there was only one thing that was great in Bapu when he was young, when he was Mohandas, and that is, he had truckloads of conviction. He says, if somebody were to ask when was Mohandas or the Mahatma born, he said, I would trace it at the age of 14 when he was sitting in a restaurant in London called High Holborn. A friend of his in London offers him a glass of alcohol. The same friend tells him, it is bitterly cold in London, please drink. He also gives him chicken to eat, non-veg to eat. Now Mohandas, his mother Putli Bai had exacted a promise from him. Beta, when you go to London, you will not do three things. Give this particular solemn promise to your mother. Mohandas was a child who said, what is it, mother? The mother said, you will not mix indiscriminately with women. Your morality should never be compromised. This little boy said, yes, mother. The mother said, you will not touch alcohol and intoxicants. Babu said, yes. And the third promise was, you will never ever take non-veg food. Mohandas said, I'm giving you my promise. The friend in London, and Mohandas was not having money, the friend turns out to be a benefactor, a person who's helping him out, and he says, you drink, no problem. Mohandas said, no, I will never do it because I've given a promise to my mother. You know what this person said? The typical language of an average youngster who is ignorant, and what is more devastating, he's ignorant that he's ignorant. This is a modern day youth. It's not ignorance, it's ignorant that he's ignorant. This friend in London said, Are you please take it. This is a cold country, there is no problem. Why do you want to uphold the promise you gave to a woman in Gujarat? You know what Mohandas did at the age of 14 and a half? He got up and said, because that woman is my mother and my word is my promise. And the third line, that was when the Mahatma was born. He said, if you think that I cannot exist in London without alcohol and non-veg, please be kind enough to buy me a ticket with the same money to go back to Porbandar. But I will not mortgage my conscience.
To Professor Anil Kumar, sir. Every time we want to do some service, there is an equally important work at home. What should we do?
Thank you. Equally important work at home, service outside. Meaning, we consider service outside different from work at home. I'm sorry. Work at home is as important as service outside. It was Kasturi who asked Swami, Sarva Dharman Parichatya, Mamekam Charanam Braja. Give up all dharma, all other activities, Maam me ekam only charanam vraja surrender to me. So Swami, how to give up all those activities and surrender to you only? How impossible. Baba is Baba, latest God. Who can give such answers? What did he say? All dharmas are divine, God's dharmas. There is nothing like swadharma, paradharma. Everything is paramatma only. Everything is God's work. The question of parichaya, giving it up, does not arise. Then your work, my work, then parichaya. Everything is your work. There is no question of parichaya. So homework is equally important, even more important. And Swami's discourses to many women on Women's Day, I very well remember. Let all women take care of their houses, take care of their children, take care of their husbands. It is spiritual sadhana to you. That's what Baba said. So spiritual sadhana does not mean coming to the streets alone. First to take care of. And one old lady told Swami, my young child is bothering me, Swami. What shall I do? Grandchild is bothering me. Grandchild, that doesn't bother, he can't be grandchild after all. They bother. And you know what Baba said? Giving birth to your grandchild is Abhisheka. Feeding your grandchild is Nairija. Singing lullaby to your grandchild, Ekanta Seva, Pavadipu Seva, that is spiritual view. So spiritualizing daily life is the success keynote of Bhagavan, Sri Sathya Baba of our age. I am glad to bring to your attention that point. And then Vijayaninan was speaking about the liquor, beer and all that. Good. There are some people that believe that liquor is liquor, and whiskey is not whiskey. But at the same time, I can tell you, my friend, correct experience I am telling you. Baba will not allow you to touch beer bottle or whiskey. Take it from me. He will, because he is God. Simple example. It is recorded in a book. I will give you page number also. Two fellows from overseas came to Prasanthadev with bottles. But they don't drink water, you see, after all. They don't drink water, no. They brought aqua. So they were sitting there after Swami's darshan. They retired, and then two fellows sat in front of each other, bottles. To cover that beer or whiskey, whatever may be, poured out, cheers, come on, let us drink. What happened? It is not whiskey, aqua, water, H2O. The fellows were very much worried, what's wrong with it? They poured out and again filled it. Same water. Finally, they took the bottle straight away. Kala. Same water. Next morning, they sat for darshan. Swami said, cheers, cheers, what happened last night? Cheers, what happened last night? So he will not ever give into touch. My friends, we are dealing with children of today. Children of today have got to be tackled carefully. Those who are grandparents will know well. I read also a joke somewhere. It says the father was telling his son, "Arey, sonny, you should read very well. At your age, Washington, George Washington, stood first in the school, you know." And the boy immediately said, "Daddy, at your age, he became president of America." And particularly grandchildren staying abroad, you cannot force them. If they wear yellow frock, why not white? Why? That question immediately will come. Why? I can't say, shut your mouth. They'll say, please back off. So we elders should be convinced, as you're telling, of what we are doing. Be role models, convince them, and slowly take them along the way. By then at 6:30, will you come or not? I'm sorry, Dad, you go in your own way. It's not the way. I go there, slowly convince them, give them the thrill and the joy. So any enforcement, any compulsion, any legislation will be a total failure. It will be purely voluntary, backed with logic, rationale, and reasoning. What is required today? Thank you. Sai Ram.
We have time running out, but we also have another session tomorrow for question answer. So we will take it up again tomorrow as well in the afternoon. But one last question, and this is for Mr. Vinay. Myself being a chartered accountant, I was in full-time practice but could not practice Sathya and Dharma. So I just take up assignments. I think he's practicing part-time. So how do we go about practicing Sathya and Dharma in this profession to Sri Vinay Kumar?
I remember Professor Venkatraman, who is a senior member of the organization, once delivering a talk in Maleshwaram, I think. And he, during the talk, cited an incident of somebody who asked Swami this question. Probably he was a chartered accountant, was not a chartered accountant, that is besides the point. He actually asked Swami, I am not able to continue working in my present job because it involves a lot of compromise on dharma. Because he used the word dharma there, not satya. And Swami immediately gave an answer, if your job requires you to compromise on dharma, better leave that job. There is no two ways about doing anything compromising on satya and dharma. So if we feel that we have to do something by which we need to compromise on the value of truthfulness or righteousness, we should choose the way out. And I think, my dear friend, whoever has asked this question, you have done the right thing because you have opted out of that kind of an existence and you are now practicing where there is ample scope to practice truthfulness and righteousness. Being somebody in practice, I can vouch for this. There are a number of occasions where a client comes and you are forced to certify or say something which is not right, which is not truthful, which is not correct according to the law of the land. But that is where the deep-rooted teaching of Swami helps us time and again. And this is where I think that 1 minute spent with him in the morning, 1 minute in the daytime and 1 minute at night helps you a lot, because the conscience from within will prick you. And like Sir said, just as he would not allow those two foreigners to drink liquor and convert the liquor into water, Swami will never, never, never allow us to follow a path which is not on Satya and Dharma. So there is, let us not even feel for a moment that we are handicapped because we have to do something which is against Satya and Dharma and that will affect our practice. The chartered accountancy profession has got such a lot of scope now in terms of so many things that have been added to it, and the regulatory agencies have made it so clear that there is no compromise required on Sathya and Dharma in most of the works which are done by us. The profession has become extremely transparent. Just as a case in point, I'm talking about CA, because this is asked by a chartered accountant. The profession itself has become so transparent. The regulatory agencies have become so clear in the regulations. There is hardly, I think, one or two I can count on my fingers where we need to compromise on this in the process of certification. Since you are in practice, I think the only area where you will need to compromise is when you certify, and there is no scope to compromise on Sathya and Dharma in a certification exercise by a chartered accountant anymore. But like Vijay Menon said, the literature of Swami, which is available here, I think if you keep reading Swami's literature and spending time with him on our own, in our own way, this is, I think, the real prescription to ensure that we are on the right path. And that is the path to God, and that is the Godward path. Sarah.
Before we conclude, I just recall what Swami said of an ideal student. He said an ideal student should have the head of Shankara the heart of Buddha and the hands of Janaka. When he depicted the ideal personality in this manner, obviously he was indicating that the three HV, the head, the heart and the hands, together should become harmonious and united. When you're working with your hands, be as efficient as possible, as Janaka was. When you are looking at any issue and analyzing it with your head, use your utmost capacities to comprehend the issue thoroughly. If you do not understand, ask people who have better understanding of that particular topic, but analyze it well, think it out well, plan it out well, and also ask yourself this question: will the Lord like me to do this? This is what Swami used to tell the students. Ask yourself, will Swami like me to do this? Is it good? Is it bad? See, this discrimination power is something which each one of us has to cultivate. And you start young, you have an added advantage. You can leverage that advantage throughout your life. And this head and the hand is not sufficient. Swami said you must also have the heart of Buddha. So the connecting link is actually your heart. When your heart is filled with compassion, automatically you will know in a particular circumstance what you should do. See, that is what Swami himself represented in his own life and in his own personality. He was able to achieve so much, whether it's his educational institutions, his water projects, his hospitals, his gram seva, his various activities. It is because he had totally integrated the head, the heart and the hands, and there cannot be a better practitioner of this dictum: head in the forest, hands in society. That is why Swami said, my life is my message. With these few words, I thank our panelists for their wonderful elucidation. Of course, my table is filled with lots and lots of questions, but as I said, we have another question answer session tomorrow, and we shall take up some of those questions in tomorrow's session. Thank you.
We had a wonderful and inspiring session and discussion on hands in the society and head in the forest. The distinguished members of the panel live this message in their everyday lives, and we are indeed very grateful Sri Sanjay Sani sir, Professor Anil Kumar sir, Sri Vijay Menon sir, and Sri Vinay Kumar sir for sharing with us your experience and wisdom and answering all our queries. We thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Thank you.